So good morning, everyone. Nice to see so many people here. Is there anyone here who isn't presenting something today or tomorrow? Do we have actual audience members? We do. Yes. Great. Okay. So my name is Tuomas. I'm from Hanken School of Economics, so most of my actual research deals with things like business simulations, temporal propositions of strategy, of organizational play and things like that. So since we are here at the Department of Anthropology, I sort of reminds me that I feel like Malinowski, I'm sitting in my hut and waiting for the natives to come and tell me how they do things, so how the people who actually get to LARP play the game. So I've been sliding away a bit from this part. But I dabble a lot on this topic still. We have a group at Hanken called GOALS, which is short for Gamified Organizational Advantages for Leadership and Strategy. So we're trying to combine game studies, LARP research, and then organizational stuff. So I'm gonna steal a lot of ideas from here and put them to effective use. My topic today is LARP research and game studies, and I think I had a subtitle which says something about experiences from 2 decades of uneasy coexistence. So this is the main point to take. These are areas that work together in many senses, but they are still slightly apart, especially in the public eye of people who work with digital games, sort of asking, what's the relevance of this? Why should we actually look into physical gaming instead of just what's being done in the digital side where the real money is? But what I'm going to do is present some key points from the history, not all of them, but some examples on what's been taking place and where we might have experienced these paradigmatic turns or situations where the same people collide in both fields and create connections. And if something I say doesn't make sense, feel free to also interrupt me or say, this was completely different in Russia. Okay. So my central points are that game studies happily reinvented the wheel on study of games around the year 2000. This did not start there, but we know that it was, frankly, cultural historians and anthropologists who created most of the early game studies work, whether it was Buitendijk or Huizinga, Kalua, others, Clifford Geertz. So we've been relying actually on a lot of theory that's been gathered from the field. But then we got to the point where it started to be digital game playing armchair theorists mostly who were looking into these things. And well, LARP research has done the same thing and it keeps doing it so that every community comes up with its own LARP theory and then they pick and mix the classic play and game theories and a bit from the digital games community, from theater theory, from performance theory, from rituals, and so forth. But at the same time, we've had these existing traditions, where I'm gonna point out several a bit later. And also, the games that are currently entering the market, whether they are digital or whether they are LARPs, they keep blurring these boundaries already. If we're looking at the major Harry Potter-style LARPs or vampire games being run in Poland, what seems to be the most important point is that they have great digital footprints that can be then spread throughout. So sort of, is it a great game or does it look great in pictures? So what's the key point here? The digital content or the actual LARP? Maybe both. So. But these sort of keep coming up, these questions where the lines actually blur. And at the same time, we keep finding these historical examples, like early reenactment at some king's court or the Games of Abydos, organized 2 millennia ago in Egypt. and so forth, sort of these ritualistic performances. So what exactly counts as LARP and what does not? I usually separate the activity of LARP from, or setting of LARP from the activity of LARPing. You can LARP in a situation that is not defined as a LARP. So if you're deeply in a character while you're doing historical reenactment, I would say you're actually LARPing, but you're not doing it in a LARP, you're doing it in another setting. Right now I'm here LARPing a LARP scholar, so it functions rather well. Same way you can be playful in a situation that isn't play, or when you're playing with a small child some board game. You're playing, but you probably aren't playful, especially after the 27th round of the same boring game, but you're gonna play still. So, and this is a game theory argument instead of a LARP studies point, so where we draw the line is a bit tricky. So, where we would normally see most of the influence of live action role-playing studies was, of course, the study of online role-playing games. This is your standard, deeply immersive example of people being really in character while playing World of Warcraft. I may joke about this, but we know there are actual role players on these. In other virtual worlds, it's more common. And there has been some very interesting crossing over. For example, one of the current key people running EVE Online, which is one of the most popular and also one of the most studied MMORPGs, Andy Nordgren has been a central figure in Swedish and Nordic live-action role-playing, from which she then moved into digital game design. So she's been taking a lot of LARP ideas, including participation into the design, into that community. So we are seeing design influences in these as well, even though this looks sort of funny. What would you guess is my example of what is currently being the point where they're mostly borrowing stuff from live action role playing studies? It's this. It's Pokemon Go. Because we've been doing actually the longest these sort of semi-pretense plays where people are mixing reality with added elements. We just did it with the other theories. A lot of pervasive gaming and augmented reality theory was developed by people who were actually first and foremost role-playing scholars. So it's logical that those principles have then been applied in other areas to understand how people use location-based gaming. Of course, there are other influences like geocaching, urban exploration, and others, but still, it's these theory frameworks through which these are best understood come actually largely from a live action roleplay background. Now, if we look into sort of these historical examples, the first place where I would sort of point out role-playing theory and physical role-playing theory appearing, even though it's not called LARP, is in the works of Roger Calois, first and foremost in Man, Play and Games, normally attributed to, I think, the year 56. But there are also pieces in his earlier work on religion. It has an appendix, the book called Man and the Sacred. So again, here we see the influences of certain scientific disciplines, not to mention anything relating to where we currently exactly are, but sort of looking into this phenomenon as human behavior and cultural forms. And Calois lists these four types of playing or game playing. So there's agon, which is competition and challenge. There is alea, which is chance. And then come the two others, which are of interest to role-playing scholars. The first of those is mimicry, so pretense, which would seem like an immediately logical fit with a lot of role-playing. And I would, of course, as well say that it's accurate. But there is the fourth, which is called eelings, the sense of vertigo, where you, for example, go to a really quickly going Ferris wheel at a carnival or something, The idea is to mess with your head, with your sense of perception, your sense of where you are. And I've actually argued that a lot of live action role playing isn't first and foremost a form of mimicry. It's a form of healings. It's about messing with your identity through the tools of pretense. So we're using mimicry, but we're actually seeking healings. At least some people who we call immersive players are. But here we see the sort of shared roots of how people have been in the classics of game studies looking into the kind of pretense which we now call LARP. The next point comes, 48 years later. For those of you who do not know, this is obviously called Beyond Role and Play. It's the third Knutpunkt conference book. Comes from Solmu Kohta 2004 in Finland. And this was the first book within the Nordic LARP community that tried to actually get a more academic approach. It was not peer-reviewed, it was not formalized in that sense, but they aimed for also academically credible contributions, which shows in the ways how much it is now cited in game studies works as well. But this was also remarkable for several other reasons. And first of all, the editors, Markus Montola and Jaakko Stenroos, who may be familiar names now to those who work within role-playing studies, they had this brilliant idea of asking game studies professor Franz Mäyrä to write the foreword and, in a sense, legitimize this collection of research to also the game studies community. It had the added benefit that Franz later recruited them both to his unit, which meant that we suddenly had role-playing scholars in Finland tightly tied to one of the first large game studies university units in the whole world. So it was an important move and cleared away a lot of the red tape that others would have otherwise needed to cross on. For example, why is your live action role-playing studies relevant? I think, or firmly believe, that I graduated at least 2 years faster because they had cleared the way for me so that I did not have to explain in the same unit what I was doing and why I was doing it, even though I was in a different section there. But this, I would say, is a central volume in that it opened the way. And since its editors have become prominent figures in both game studies and in role-playing studies, it's sort of been a logical bridge work for both. At the same time, we had another volume appearing. I think this actually came out a bit earlier. This is considered the sort of game studies Bible. So, Rules of Play by Katie Zeilen and Eric Zimmerman. And it's Bible in also the sense that feel free to disagree with it, but you have to acknowledge that it exists if you're debating the topic. So it's included a lot of these short considerations on what the existence of role-playing, and especially live-action role-playing, might mean to game studies. Because, for example, almost all of the classic definitions of games include that there is some sort of an ending or victory condition. But if we think about LARP campaigns or tabletop role-playing campaigns, the whole point is to keep the game going. If there is an end condition, it's usually sort of just boring or you're wrapping it up in order to start something new. So you win by continuing play. And in this sense, role-playing games represent a very interesting limit case game for game studies, because their purpose seems to be rather different from almost all other forms of games. Frankly, looking at it from now, the LARP examples in this book are outdated, to put it kindly. I would say even simplistic. So some of these old first vampire LARPs, we would not recognize that much LARPing in them, more like social interaction based on rules and shallow roles. But still, it carried some key theories from people like Kurt Lancaster, who has done some very interesting work during this era and also a bit later on, some forms of LARP, which may not be nowadays very interesting in themselves, sort of very simple fantasy LARP. But the theory frameworks created through those are still worth looking, even though they come, let's say, from 99. So there is some valuable stuff also in this, if we can just look past the games. And the basic principles on how to relate live action role play to other types of games actually are quite well present in this particular volume, so it's still worth a look. How many of you have actually read this book? Did you read all of it? Yeah, so I suspected. Like I said, it's the Game Studies Bible. A lot of people just skip the boring parts.
What about you?
No.
The heavy theories at the beginning, that's what I mean. So.
Yeah, yeah. But this and its companion, which collects these classical texts for example, game definitions and so forth, from Suits and others, is quite valuable as well. I actually want to mention Bernard Suits here also, because his book The Grasshopper, written in 1978, also contains discussions on sports and other physical activities, including sex as potential forms of games and physical play. So he's blurring quite a bit the line on what he defines as game, and this way sort of his game definition fits LARPs a lot better than many of the other classical forms, simply because it takes into account the player's strong physical presence. So a lot of his examples come from boxing, and many of those theories, like for example, when you enter this Huizinga's magic circle, the rules and moralities become different. It is not okay for a boxer to not try to hit the opponent. Same way, if you're going to a LARP, it's not okay to play directly against what the game master has written in your character, even though it feels sort of immoral, the actions what there are. Of course, we know players do this.
Sure.
Yeah, but in principle, the idea is that you have to follow different frameworks. Yes,
since
Jason?
Since you brought up the grasshopper, Suits also draws distinctions between role-playing and theater.
Yeah.
Later in the book, where he suggests that when you do theater, you're taking on a persona for other people to take you as that character, in some sense to substitute for that character. Whereas when you role play, you're doing it for the act of being that character. Like the principle, it's not first person audience, it's more motivational in the way that he talks about it.
Yeah.
It's kind of a lovely chapter, actually.
Yes, we can deduce from that, as I will later on say, that he probably had not read anything by Konstantin Stanislavski, so...
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah, but sort of to stay in the 2000s again for a while. The next interesting piece is here. We see Professor Maurer's name again. This is actually a later revision, but the original 2005 article, Fundamental Components of the Gameplay Experience, is a central text for looking at immersion in play. And while it's not explicitly mentioned in the text, it is obvious that the authors have been familiar already by now with the first arising ideas from how live-action role players view immersion. And this is one of the most cited texts on game immersion still. So sort of we're not seeing the citations yet in 2005, but we are seeing already the influences taking place and the legitimization. And this has continued then in other topics and occasionally when you find a digital game research article or book which takes it for granted that immersion is only for digital games. It's a point where it quite quickly gets attacked. Gordon Kajea in his book from 2011 has really nice definitions for immersion, but he never mentions the digital in that content, and it's obvious that the principles would totally fail if we look at it from a LARP perspective. So it could be fixed with adding two words, but that's in the book, but that's how it goes. But sort of the immersion discussion has been fueled quite strongly by the presence of role players in the game studies community. It's good to keep in mind. So, whereas if you look at other forms of discussion on what we might call immersion, like the concepts of presence or telepresence or game engagement, there we see a lot less of the role-playing influence taking place. These are slightly merging here and there. I've done some editorial work as well to promote these connections, but sort of still, immersion is the word where you most see still these influences, at least being present, even if not noted. My next example is this article. So we're still in 2005. This is a game studies piece, and we have the words live action role-playing games in the title, so the key point is what can LARP actually offer for pervasive gaming, which was sort of just starting at this point. The first experiments were being done, we're still sort of going towards the direction of the first larger pervasive LARPs, like Prosopopeia and others, which were EU-funded examples. This was a clever work in the sense that it combines points here and there for LARP and sort of really considers what can we know from here. It's also a very problematic article, which I have been perhaps a bit unfairly over the years been using as a negative example of how things are done. What the researchers did was they went and looked at basically one British fantasy game and then generalized as if that were all of LARP. So obviously the implications are going to be quite off the mark. And it was also problematic in the sense that plenty of others early on cited this as an authoritative piece on LARP. So it colored the vision of many game studies scholars on what LARP actually is, what it could be, and sort of how wide it can be topic-wise. So it locked us into the classic stupid fantasy gaming perspective for quite a while, and it was a hole that it wasn't so easy to dig out of, even though there were already people saying otherwise elsewhere. And from this we logically come to DGRA, so the Digital Games Research Association, which is one of the most active game studies communities in the world. It's not the only one, but one of the most active. And it focuses especially on recreational gaming. While there are the words digital there, it's always been open to the exploration of other forms of gaming as well. So there have been board game articles, there have been role-playing articles from tabletop to LARP in their digital libraries and conferences. And there has been a constant, sometimes rather blatant subgroup which keeps going to the events and demanding that the name be changed to GRA. And it's like this horde of zombies in some situations where people are going just like grah, grah, grah. But the key goal is to remove the digital and to see the wider scene. It's effectively there already. The name just has stuck, so I don't think it's that bad. And it occasionally gets ridiculous. But there's been also some interesting crossover. Jaakko Stenroos, whom I mentioned before, for example, at DIGRAS conference, I think it was in 2011, I might be wrong, but around there, he organized to demonstrate how LARP might be interesting. He organized at the conference itself two runs of my Being Hungover and Mean LARP, Prayers on a Porcelain Altar, to digital game scholars, and those were run in two cargo containers simultaneously. So the containers were open at one end, people were playing, and Jaakko was running between the two to runtime game master if there were any problems. After this, we started seeing in some of the participants' work sort of clear notes of at least the existence of LARP and that it might be interesting for others. So it's been, these conferences have been a good venue for getting in touch with the digital researchers and talking about the implications and importance of LARP studies. And like I mentioned, pervasive game theory, which we're now seeing in a lot of ARGs, but also other games, those were defined in several works, but I would say this is the most authoritative one from 2009. And if you look at the names coming from top to bottom words, we have again Markus Montola, Jaakko Stenroos, and the pervasive game project lead, Annika Wern, who is a human-computer interaction scientist first and foremost, but she's been LARPing for a long time and familiar with this. But this is the work that codified a lot of the principles, then was a bit forgotten when pervasive gaming did not take off that well, and is now seeing a renaissance 7 years after its publication, even though it's outdated a bit here and there, but to explain how people relate to things like Pokemon Go. So it's making a comeback. How many of you are familiar with this journal?
Yes.
Okay, one. Okay, as I suggest everyone here take a look at it at some point because I'm currently one of its three editors. Simulation and gaming is interesting because like a couple of other game studies journals, it did not have the digital game definition in its article lists. So around 2010, a bunch of role-playing scholars, myself included, found this as a potential journal for where to publish role-playing related research if we did not want to go to the International Journal of Role-Playing, which was established in 2006. So SNG, which focuses especially on instrumental gaming and educational gaming, turned out into this sort of place where to legitimize again role-playing research, because sort of when it's published in a respected academic journal, then it becomes sort of something that can be properly cited. Simulation and gaming was established in 1970, so it carries a history far longer than the official history of game studies, the discipline. So this arises more from the management and military training games tradition that started in the 50s to move into computers. So it comes through a tradition of its own and is strongly connected to things like the American Association for Business Simulations, which has also been experimenting with role plays for a long time. This ties into Model United Nations, if any of you have participated in that. Again, a very live action role play kind of thingy. So these antecedents exist here quite strongly. And this, for example, is one of the central early texts. So late 80s, an article by the previous editor of SNG, David Krugol, and two of his colleagues. And this article, which discusses different types of simulations and their uses, specifically mentions role plays as a form of educational interesting play, and the descriptions of role playing in this and other central simulation and gaming contributions is something that it's quite easy to recognize as relating more to LARP than, for example, tabletop role play or Moreno's sociodrama or something like that. So we're moving in territory that is almost implicitly friendly to LARP as long as it's framed in the right way. When we found this article in 2010, my colleagues in LARP studies said, okay, if we had seen this 10 years earlier, we would be talking a lot more about simulation than games, so it sort of makes sense in that way. But by now we obviously have an established terminology and more of a framework still with the recreational digital gaming community because of historical ties than, for example, with the simulation and gaming community or its central conferences like ISAGA. And now to move to the next point. So I think this is one of the most important, even though it hasn't been as influential as we hoped. This is a free book by ETC Press, available online. You can download it. It's created as a methodology guide for all sorts of game studies scholars. And this is a book actually where you can find stuff on, for example, LARP debriefing by using video analysis and stimulated recall. And it's just there as sort of, this obviously belongs in this volume. So this was published in early 2015, if I remember correctly. But sort of very interesting in that here we see the communities fully integrated and contributing already to each other. Also a very convenient book for anyone to look at cost-free if you're looking into sort of something where you can justify what you're doing with the right points or want to add some extra methodological references for example, how to do ethnography in a LARP. So it's a nice tool. And then you can expand from that into the more classical stuff or the weirder ethnological books. So,
clarify, is this for researching, this is methods for researching games, not methods for using games as research?
This is first and foremost methods for researching games.
Okay.
But you can, if I remember correctly, find also stuff that is for the other purpose as well.
Are there any hints for those who have difficulties in being insiders and can't, look from the
higher level.
Yeah, from the upper position.
I don't think this one has that many. I use the works of John van Manen a lot for this purpose. So the father, van Manen, the father of organizational ethnography. And he's been writing about, for example, how to define your position within an organization or culture. B-A-N.
V, the first
one. V A N.
You can write it down on the board.
No,
actually.
No.
The marker is not really good.
Okay, the marker is great.
Okay, but I'll ask you during.
Yeah. We have time. Thank you, Jason. Can you see my awful handwriting?
John van Manen.
Van Manen, yes. The pronunciation, I think, should be still rougher. He was a person who went through police training in order to study cops in their work environments in the 70s. And he has some rather harsh texts because he was sort of one of the guys, he was able to ride in patrol cars and say stuff like how what they responded in interviews differed from what they actually did in the field. And I have to recommend, it's a bit off the topic, but for LARP researchers might be still relevant. He has a wonderful article on police brutality, which is called The Asshole, which defines anyone who is being difficult and against these options. So this is a guy who did not shy away from difficult topics, and this is also why he's useful for looking into certain LARP phenomena, especially on sort of, this person was obviously doing just drama building or competitive play, and now he's saying, I did these decisions because it felt right for my character. So at this point, I'm immediately picking John's old book. You know, sometimes the best books are actually from completely outside of the area, and still they're useful. Which brings me nicely to sort of the re-emergence of classical traditions. So this is actually not a LARP studies book. This is a book about varieties of theatrical and performative arts and situations. And I just sort of use this as a collective reminder of the fact that a lot of the current theory draws from performance by people like Keith Johnstone's improv or Richard Schechner's theater theory, which was in turn influenced by ritual theory, by Victor Turner and so forth. So we're seeing these lines of development. Actually, Kaluar's work was developed together with Bataille, who talks about transgression. And so forth. So we're actually seeing a lot of game theory from early on interfacing with fields like anthropology and cultural analysis and ethics. But sort of this represents also the fact that classics like Stanislavski are being currently dug up. Augusta Boal's work as well, and others, to explain both more recreational LARPs and business LARPs and management training simulations, crisis training, others. So they're resurfacing. Same with what little research is actually existing on historical reenactment. Then there's the psychodrama stuff. One of my PhD students is actually doing his work now on comparing live action role playing with psychodrama and sociodrama, because he's trained as a guide in those. So again, these topics keep popping up. And since a lot of the game studies community relies on these for certain key terms, just as it does on Goffman, so it means again that in many cases they find it easiest to explain the, let's say for example, theatrical connections through the use of live action role playing theory, which has already been discussing these connections for a lot longer than the digital scholars have, or the management scholars for that matter. So it's a field where there is a lot of work still being done and could be done. Okay, and now I'm going to move to some examples from recent years. I already mentioned ISAGA, so the International Simulation and Gaming Association. It had its conference last year in Kyoto, Japan. This is the proceedings book, which is this thick, so dozens of articles. It's also online. It's frankly horribly priced, but kind authors might be able to supply you with PDF copies of their chapters. But what is interesting is that in this book about educational gaming and instrumental gaming, there are present, again, several live-action role-playing articles which were accepted by the community as a completely logical part of this section. There is one very nice piece by Björn Ole Kamm, a German cultural scholar who resides in Kyoto semi-permanently. There is one chapter, I think, by Alexei Fedoseyev, by himself, or was it with a co-author? Can't remember right now, but sort of it's been featured. And by the way, the ISAGA community has a long, tight history with Russian game studies. So it's one where you can actually find the classical names much more often than, for example, in Digra, where they only cite those who have been translated into English. So it's just Vygotsky, basically. But here we are seeing mentions of other theorists. Stuff from Melkonen keeps popping up, others as well. So I think currently the most interesting connections are happening within the Isaga section, rather than, for example, Digra. The sad thing is it's a lot smaller community, so this does not mean that there's so much. But it's a place where to look for interesting new connections, especially if you're working with, for example, EduLARP, then it fits quite nicely with the conferences. And another is the sort of legitimization of live action role play research into sort of the normal game studies environment. So David Simkin's book, The Arts of LARP, which is mostly about special educational play. I've seen it on the shelves now of many game studies units. In the middle, the blurry one, that's Jaakko Stenroos's amazing doctoral dissertation, which won the award as the best PhD dissertation of its university for that year, which carries sort of, well, frankly, a fluent combination of live-action role-play theory, other role-play theories, game studies theories, especially theories of play. Again, something freely available online. A dissertation is not the easiest read, but this is also quite a good read. So, yes, I would say the award for the best PhD of its year went to a book that's based on live action role playing theories and then expands from that to game studies and play studies. So
it's really very helpful for theoretical parts of the articles because it covers almost all you might need.
Yeah. But it's a great place to start, especially if you want to look for the combinations or if you want to convince other people that what you're doing is really significant, relevant and high quality. So it's a good marketing pitch tool, I would say, as the business scholar. So, and in the United States, we're also seeing these events like the WordCon books, which do a lot of documentation and cites enough game studies works that they've drummed up interest in other game scholars as well. It's not a wonder that both digital game scholars and designers nowadays come to visit high-profile LARPs to learn something new, the same way as Disney executives go there to borrow or steal ideas. So we're seeing a development there. And I want to also mention that International Journal of Role Playing, which I used to edit for a while, and it was launched in 2006. I don't remember, I think the first issue came out in 2008 then. It has been consistently listed in, for example, the Wikipedia entry for Game Studies Journal, because it includes both digital role-playing, educational role-plays of different kinds, non-game role-playing, and LARP. It's a nice way of connecting and keeping the field active. And after a two-year break, it was just last week reactivated with no less than 3 new issues.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Finally. So,
because they published the stuff from last summer, right?
Yes. So.
So you want me to?
Oh no, I didn't send them anything. I was in a rush finishing my master's, you know.
Yeah, so this two of these issues are basically proceedings from last year's Living Games, no, this year's Living Games conference, and a seminar quite like this one, which preceded the convention. So sort of different types of both practical and highly research-oriented works in there. But I, again, strongly suggest you go and take a look. And finally, as sort of some sign of a warning before I conclude, in some areas it's still sort of difficult to get live action role play research or even role playing research taken completely seriously. So recently publishers have been interested in taking books that deal with this topic. But for example, here it says essays on participatory media and role playing. So role playing content wasn't enough for the publisher. They wanted something else in order to sell it to a wider audience. So we had to pitch in some reality TV articles, some of which are actually great in this book, but still sort of it felt like selling out. And now there's going to come out a role-playing research handbook from Routledge next year, which has an extensive LARP chapter as well. It's primary author, and it has been sheer hell to edit because of different voices, communities, and what is the focus, but it's going to come out. But again, that book has the subtitle of Transmedia Foundations. So again, they wanted a larger audience, and we have to package it a bit differently. So it seems that at least the marketing people aren't taking us as seriously as they should. So to summarize my points, the influence of LARP research, it keeps expanding. It's more noted, it's seen in both design and development, in markets as actually a sold product and tool. It's implicitly there in a lot of game studies research these days, also in educational gaming, and there are a lot of bridges we can build. More and more, a lot of the people who are looking into LARP are not full-time professionals studying LARP, especially not after their PhDs. So it's more like a side hobby in a sense. So sort of this is where I come from. I want to do one article on LARP every year, but they research something else, or they develop digital games and have moved on to industry side. And it seems that LARP as LARP is more easily appreciated in the context of, for example, educational gaming. So there it's easier to just sort of say that this is the method that I'm using, and people are not thinking, what could this give to, well, actual games? But they're sort of thinking that, okay, now you're running a role play exercise in the classroom, next you're gonna be using a storytelling card game or something like that. So there it fits well, and this is what, for example, the Saga Proceedings books show quite well. But it's still occasionally a hard sell, even though we have games like College of Wizardry and others that draw a lot of media attention. So sort of it's still an uphill battle, and frankly, I suspect that the reason why a lot of LARP researchers move into other fields is simply because it's a lot easier to get funding for the study of digital gaming, or business gaming for that matter. So in a sense, a lot of us become sellouts eventually in order to pay the bills rather than do that which we love. There's also the sad fact that a game with 80 million players gives you a lot more readers than if you write about a 10-player Swedish LARP, so there is this attention seeking as well. But sort of as long as this community stays active in the sense that LARPs keep popping up in discourses, and it's not just documentation but also actual analysis, I think we're basically doing fine. And what we are doing increasingly does not have to explain its value to anyone. It's not taking for granted, it's taking for what it actually is. So in that sense, it's nice, at least dabbling still in that area as well, even if I am sitting most of the time outside and just hearing others talk about how amazing these 500 euro games were. So let's talk more. Any questions? Thank you for listening.
Thank you for amazing overview. I think otherwise we would never get such a great survey. Thank you.